During my year as mayor, I keep on coming across many different organisations that help so many different people within the community, and your help's vital to everybody. So thank you, and well done again for getting your certificates today in this most beautiful building. I've never been in here before, and it's beautiful, and it's a lovely setting for this, so thank you very much. I'm standing here in the Guildhall next to the City's Freedom Board, which lists the many honorary freemen that have been made by the city. They include Elgar, and I'm standing next to his bust. He was given the freedom of the city in 1905 by his close friend Herbert Lester.
See you.
We're just waiting.
Yes, I'm a little bit early. Well, I'm being filmed at the moment with a cameraman. And I don't want this to sound as though I'm being boastful or anything like that, but I think if you were to talk to my fellow councillors, I think they would say that, yes, I had been a good mayor who'd worked hard and had cheered many people up. I would say one of the highlights was Prince Charles's visit. And the Three Choirs Festival was very special. But then there's so many other memories. And I think if I was to have a photo album in front of me, just by looking at a picture, I could remember, oh, that was a group visiting the parlour, or I was visiting the hospital, or another organisation. There's so many memories that it's not really fair to single out too many of them. And I'll miss being centre of attraction, really. It's been rather good.
When they get down the picker, the tractor driver unloads his own load. And he has a lot of number of people waiting on him to make sure that the binds are all separated and the little bits are all put through the machine. It runs from 7:30 in the morning with a couple of breaks during the day, and finishes at 5:30 at night. And by evening, I think everybody's tired.
We start off in the loading bay where the hops are brought in on the specially built trailers and hung on to this conveyor system, which takes the hops up, and then they start descending through a set of what we call picking routers.
One of the most audacious examples of community regeneration is undoubtedly Cael Narfon's magnificent gallery.
I've come to Carnarvon today to see the gallery and some of the development work around the town, which I hope we can learn from as examples of best practice. I'm a town councillor within the town of Towgarth. I'm also the acting secretary and vice chair of the Towgarth and District Regeneration Group. The gallery itself is a wonderful building with a multiple range of use. with the soundproof studios, the general studios, which are multi-use, the main theatre building, which again can be used in many ways, the office spaces, which brings a number of people into the building and gives it a life every day. So it's a tremendous facility that benefits the whole of the community, and its use has increased year on year in the 3 years it's been open.
Well, with this kind of an organisation, of course, it is essential that we seek any kind of finance that's possible to fund a project. As far as capital funding is concerned, we have been successful in attracting lottery money, and particularly European money for building the gallery itself. We've also been successful in attracting project grants for different things. What we can't get, of course, is core money. But we are generating something like 90% of our income ourselves through commercial activities. Therefore, the necessity to locate sources of funding is something that is always with us. We can never be comfortable here. We have a turnover of about £1.5 million, and we have to employ 42 people to run this place. And therefore, it's a lot of money to find every month. We don't have the safety cushion that many other organisations have who receive money from public sources.
Worcester Forgate Street followed a good 10 years after Worcester Shrub Hill Station, its predecessor, and the line was opened as far as Malvern Link in 1859, but Worcester Forgate Street didn't open until the following year, 1860. The station here opened along with Great Malvern Station. The line was operated by the Oxford, Worcester and Wolverhampton Railway, who already operated services from Worcester to Kidderminster and on to Wolverhampton. It was seen as an extension to that railway, an important extension through the Malverns onto the cathedral city of Hereford. The biggest test for the group was quite early on, because in 1982 we heard that British Rail had plans to downgrade the line. The state of the track was such that they felt that the intercity trains could no longer use the line due to the effect of the wear and tear on the track. And so the plan was to downgrade the line and send all the through trains from Worcester to London via Cheltenham and Gloucester. The line would have remained open, but purely for a diesel shuttle service from Worcester to Oxford. And we saw this as the first step on the road to downgrading and closure, ultimate closure of the line. So it meant an incredible battle at the time, with everything that we could do with local councils, through the MPs, through the users, major leafleting campaign and through the media to try and reverse that decision, which could have been the end for the line. And it took a good year, 18 months, until we had a meeting in Morton in Marsh. We met the general manager and chief passenger manager of British Rail in those days. It was basically rather negative. They were saying all the reasons why they couldn't run the through trains on the line anymore. And over the strawberries and cream, they seemed to relent a bit. They said, why not perhaps just keep two of the key trains in the morning and two back in the evening and see if that would work. And I think it was maybe partly the fact they had Radio Oxford, a load of reporters hanging outside waiting for a press release, press statement. I think it, in fact, won the day.
The real mysteries are when you go home at night and you feel a cold presence in a room in an old house and you turn and you think you see something or you hear something. Now that's the kind of mystery that I like to investigate. But I don't think that we will be a mass belief in this kind of thing unless a flying saucer lands at Dodger Stadium during a game. You know, then maybe people will start to say, hey, where there's more than just this planet. I've had light light experiences. You know, I've seen lights that shouldn't have been there in an old house, and I have had a vivid premonitive dream experience when my grandfather died. I was in New York City, and I wasn't even in my apartment. No one could reach me. The family couldn't reach me. I went to sleep that night, and I had a dream that he was waving goodbye to me, and I woke up the next morning, got a telegram, he was dead. Now, this is not unusual.
Well, Dan has a great psychic history in his family. He's talked about it in the past. There have been psychics in his family, and he subscribes to the Journal of the American Psychical Society. And he's always been a believer, and I have never been a believer. And what I liked about his original premise was that his characters were skeptics. There was no attempt to explain anything in a spiritual sense. All the explanations were technical. And so the characters of the Ghostbusters approach the supernatural much like janitors or exterminators. And I love that, shoving the mundane right up against the supernatural and getting that edge.
Slimer was in the very, very first draft. He was. We called him Mr. the Onion Head, the Onion Head. And basically, he always had those traits. He always was kind of sort of like a remnant of somebody who liked to enjoy life. I often kind of think maybe it's Belushi in a way coming back, in a sense, you know, because, you know, John sort of had that kind of lust for life feeling and appetites for things, and Slimer always had that trait of swallowing things and having them drain right through, and, you know, it's weird that he's got his own show. That is really strange to me, you know. The Onion Head now is like a cartoon star, which is really, really weird, because there's no way when I wrote that first scene of him haunting a guest house in upstate New York, you know, and drinking the milk out of the fridge and scaring the guests, that I ever would thought there'd be any more than that. In fact, that was his only appearance, you know.
Non-stop, and this Tops is in his element this time with some big Top Gun action. Aircraft very much the subject of this non-stop. We're visiting RAF Cosford, and this is the man who runs this place today. His name is Wing Commander Norman Brannan. That's right, isn't it?
Good morning.
Good morning, Norman. Come with me and tell me now, the air show here at Cosford has been running for how many years?
We've had the this particular form of the air show for the past 3 years.
What kind of area do you cover? We've got a map here.
For all Cosford, we cover an area of 6,000 square miles with approximately 8 million people.
It's Cosford, and so you're covering almost up to North Wales, up to where? Manchester?
Yeah, up south of Manchester, right away across to the other side of the Derbyshire border, down to Bristol, and up to the Black Mountains.
We get occasionally get the odd 4.5-5 hour round here, and it's unacceptable. 4.5-5 hours on a golf course is a hell of a long time, isn't it?
A lot of it is anticipation too. If you know somebody's going to play, you can be start thinking about your own shot.
Absolutely right. I mean, if you're prepared, you know, prior to you playing your shot, you select your club or even think about the yardage and so on. Look at the wind direction. I mean, lots of things you can do to speed the pace of play up.
Blimey, this wind is, I think it's two more big shots.
Well, it's certainly making it play long today with the breeze in our face.
Yeah. What sort of distance have I got to the green? Wow. I know my place. Yeah. Your ball looks lovely out there. Yeah. To the gorge, as I now think of it.
Well, you're looking to play a shot that's going to get you with an easy access of the green with your third shot. So you're looking to hit the ball around about 170, 180. I would think either your 3-iron or a fairway wood, one of those two. And that obviously will give you a nice ball flight through the wind. Yeah. And that will get you comfortably within range of the green then.
I think probably I'll hit the iron because it's...
Yeah, you're on a bit of... You've got the ball slightly below your feet there.
Yes, I have.
Yeah.
Okie doke.
Right, good luck.
Just slightly up left, it will go to the right.
Whoops. It's gone a little bit right. Hold your line.
Is that rough stuff there?
That's heather.
Heather?
Oh yeah, dear. You met her.
I don't wish to meet her. But I've heard a lot about her.
Well, she's tough.
Right, well, could be interesting.
Well, it's a tough shot today, into the breeze.
The green looks carry. Tiny, is it a bit bigger than
it looks? It's a little bit wider than it looks, it is wider, I mean, it's a generous green. Find out, aren't
we? Obviously we will, yeah. Gorgeous shot. Gorgeous.
Yeah, that's pretty good from that range.
And it's coming back a bit.
Yeah, it's back on the green.
Fantastic good. Shot.
It was a 48-hour week at a shilling and a halfpenny an hour. So it meant at the end of the week, you didn't take up £2.10. Your weekly wage was £2.06.
Excellent heifer entering the ring now. Lot number 280. Lactating over 50 times, producing 72 litres. This heifer's giving. Mother's still in the herd. Grandmother's still in the herd. Lovely heifer, nice milking. One first class champion udders.
When your own guns are firing, that shakes the ship up.
It blowed all my clothes off, bar a bit of me sock.
Chaps were jumping on to try and catch on the rope and were dropping in the water.
Bang, and this plane exploded. And down come the pilot or whoever it was.
There were submarines,
planes laying mines in front of the convoy, as well as dive bombers and Dorniers attacking from the air.
The worst missions were the Ruhr Valley. That's where we lost most planes.
To the left of us, which we didn't know at the time, were the Irish Guards. They were part of our brigade too. They had an anti-tank gun.
The enemy decided to chase us out, but I can't remember being particularly worried.
We knew he was missing, so that when all the troops were coming back to Dunkirk, I was studying all the faces.
The horrible thing about it was when you saw the wounded and you couldn't do nothing about it.
I nerved. I didn't want to do that, but still I had to do it.
Who said you couldn't create a raft on site? A couple of old torpedoes, several giant pallets, some lengths of washing line, generous advice from various bystanders with a strong sense of nautical engineering, and a bit of a park bench to finish it off. Will it float? We'll soon find out. A confident prediction by Dave Robinson of the White Swan pub in Bewdley. How does it look for floatability? Yes, it's time for the big lift, when rafts are queued up ready for launching. The pants of power are fed up hanging around and want to get to the water's edge. We're close to the Severn Valley Railway, but this is not an old Great Western loco, though it seems to weigh nearly as much. Will that float, we wonder? Now expertise starts to come into play. Getting the raft from the slipway and into the water requires teamwork, coordination, and brute strength. Who knows, the balloons may act as a vital buoyancy aid. This barrel of fun from a Brierley Hill supermarket is sponsored to raise funds for an Institute of the Blind. And now the floating grandstand swings into view in the hope of a horrible accident. Here's a demonstration of neat boarding technique. Well, the pressure's on to shift those rafts, but the divers take a pride in giving each gang a good send-off, not least these tax officers. Ah, the confident team. Oh well, it was great on paper.
Today's the inaugural event for the University Wheelchair Basketball Tournament.
Wheelchair basketball is an inclusive sport, so able-bodied people can play it as well, especially in the university championships.
We've got University of Durham, Northampton, obviously Worcester, Sheffield and Nottingham.
It's basically the same game, apart from obviously you're in a wheelchair. I think the biggest difference is like chair skills and having to control your chair as well as controlling the ball or shooting or something. So there's a lot of rules like a charge, like offensive fouls and things. So you've got to be able to control your chair before you shoot the ball. But yeah, it is rough. It's supposed to be non-contact, but it definitely is. And yeah, people fly out of the chairs all the time, but thankfully there's not been any major injuries today. An able-bodied player is classed as 5 points on the classification system, and someone like myself, who's the lowest pointer, is a 1 point player, and you can have 14 points on court at once. So obviously that ranges in disability, and if you play in able-bodied players as well, they're obviously worth 5 points, so it's useful to have like a 1 point player so that you can play a lot more of the higher point players.
As part of the Football Society, we're helping run an event for Sight Concern, and we're doing walking over hot coals and hoping to raise quite a bit of money with that.
Sight Concern's the county charity for the blind and partially sighted. We work with people to show them what they can do.
We found out about firewalking and we thought it'd be a bit different, something fun to do, so raising money for a good cause as well, so why not give it a go?
Apparently we're going to be walking on hot coals that are registering over, I think, 1200 degrees, and I think we're walking about 20 feet in our bare feet.
I'm registered deafblind and I go to the centre once a week for my socialising and activities. I also do a lot of fundraising for them. I'm going to walk 20 feet over hot coals.
I'm going to put all my fears behind me and hopefully get all that money in that I've generated through sponsorship.
Sight loss is a devastating experience for people, but we know from working with hundreds and thousands of people with sight loss what can be achieved when they know about the right support, the right information and how to do things differently. And we know that people can lead independent and fulfilling lives.
Used to live on the Labour. Now we've got a little plot in the corner of the field, belonged to Mr. George Gray. So I'd like to tell her and put my story over to you. The only place we could find suitable to pull the caravans on was the Labour, which you can see up here on the left-hand side.
We had a little bit of house lunch and people wanted us to go. So the council decided to put a temporary place at the top end of Dillon for us. Everybody was all over the moon about this. You know, we'd be safe, got somewhere to stay, and the children would be okay. But the night before we were due to move, the next day, on the morning part, they came and told us that the piece that was made for us up at Dillwyn had been destroyed. So we was back to square one.
What team is it? Miss? Where is it?
This is our bedroom. This caravan's 28 foot. It's nice now because it's not really cold. But when the winter comes, I have to move out of here and move into the front room because I've only got one paraffin heater to heat the old caravan. I can't put a paraffin heater in here because I'm asthmatic and I've got to have plenty of room so that the heater gets ventilation. One generator, if that generator breaks, that's it. We've got no lighting. We've pondered around outside in the dark, so we've got no light bulbs outside.
Back in the late 60s to the 70s, there was plenty of farm work. Now, 9 to 10 months through the year, people had work weekly, and they was off the road more than what they are today. There was sweet pulling, potato picking, mango pulling. We used to work behind this machine every year, a month, probably 6 weeks for the year. They used to chuck them onto this piece of machinery here, which used to clean the spuds off and chuck them out. Farmers don't want us on their land today because they haven't got the work for us.
I invited Valenti Pytel to come and look at the gardens and look at that particular site. And as we stood there, a pair of buzzards flew over the town in the sky. And he immediately said, I'd love to create a pair of buzzards to stand on this site, which would be seen from the A449 and from the town centre, and which would sort of lure people up into the gardens and encourage them to walk via the winding path up to St Anne's Well.
With my work, because it's made out of all this little bits of scrap sort of steel, you'll have bits where you can actually look through it. And that's the idea also with the sculpture, that if you can see through the piece, you'll get different sort of shapes, and different sort of interesting moments. Part of this looks black. And in Malvern, where the sculpture is, it's all virtually white galvanized steel. But if you look at it, and when the sun is shining on it, a lot of it will be totally black. I'm a good artist, and I know how to draw, and I know how to paint. I couldn't actually make something so big and paint on the floor exactly the same shape. With a projector, to project something like this, as big as this actual room, I had to wait till it gets dark. Then I put the projector outside, go 30, 40 yards back, and then project it onto the wall. And then I can do the drawing. So when I put it down on the floor, when I bend the steel, I will get the shape exactly.
I think the great skill, of course, is then to create the piece in three dimensions, to actually take each individual piece, component, if you like, up, and then create it in three dimensions.
With these scrap bits of steel, people say to me, is it going to be strong enough? But of course, with the welding I do, in the middle of it, I would put quite a lot of strong sort of pieces.
The look of Ledbury is due partly to a scheme established in the 13th century by the Bishop of Hereford to allow freemen of the town to rent strips of land. They were called burgages. They were 20 feet wide and 200 feet long, and they sprouted the narrow half-timbered houses so beloved by visitors. The market house stands on 16 stout oak pillars, originally intended to protect corn from 17th century rats. 21st century civic leaders still climb up here and trade goes on underneath, but these days the market hall serves as Britain's most distinguished bus stop. Ledbury is a good few miles from the coast, but you might get the impression of water, an illusion caused by the plastic tunnelling used locally in the production of soft fruits. There are huge orchards around here too. Cider makers and drinkers rely on them. This is Big Apple country. And half of the hops that go into England's cask ales are grown in Herefordshire. The result, some very tasty beer.
Cheers, Michael.
In the nearby hamlet of Eastnor, just below the Malvern Hills, is a fairy tale castle, erected not as a fortification, but as an impressive home for a local family. Eastnor Castle, built in the early 19th century at a cost of £85,923, 13 shillings and 11 pence halfpenny, is the setting for today's Antiques Roadshow.
Here we are in Worcester on a lovely sunny Sunday morning, with the River Severn peacefully flowing by, the Severn called Sabrina by the Romans, its great Roman city. and you may be wondering why I'm talking about the history of Worcester Porcelain Company, seated here in an old car park. But this is where it all began. In June 1751, Dr. John Wall and his co-partners founded the Worcester Porcelain Company in Wall Street House, which stood on this site. And luckily I was able to excavate the grounds many, many times, finding in the ground things like this. A little sauce boat, a waster thrown away because it went wrong in its firing. Underglaze blue, but before glazing, it's that colour. Then after glazing, turns into this magical transformation. I came to Worcester from London to sing in the cathedral choir, teach music at the Royal Grammar School and conduct, and lived in this wonderful old medieval building, the Bishop's Coach House. And interested in antiques and antiquities as I was, I excavated this little garden and found here Romans and their pots buried down below. And this got me fascinated with ceramics. So I was appointed curator of Royal Worcester in 1966, an interesting time as the museum was just about to move from this splendid Regency building behind me here into a larger Victorian school. I have a great affection for the building because it was there that Princess Elizabeth unveiled the first public museum in 1951 to coincide with the bicentenary year of the founding of the firm in 1751. So it will always stay in my heart as a lovely building. This is the old St. Peter's School in which many of the craftsmen at the factory have their education. Many of the crafts have changed over the years. Some of them are exactly the same. The museum itself has had a great refurbishment, and I'm delighted to be able to show you some of its treasures.